It's not another Buffalo podcast, hosted by three of the most underqualified sports personalities this side of the canal. With John.
All you people out there who are like, these idiots don't know anything. First of all, you're right. And second of all,
Pat. I'm just a dad talking in a closet, but like, you know, like I'm just saying.
And Brando.
We have this trust built on whatever it is, like Bibles and gold bricks and whatever Brandon Bean's drinking over there.
All right, welcome back to Not Another Buffalo Podcast. I'm John. That's Pat, the dad in the closet, Brando. And you can find us on all platforms at Not Buff Podcast. I just want to take a second to let you guys know that this episode is brought to you guys by Small City Realty. If you're looking to buy, sell, or manage property in Western New York, call our guy, Zach Korzelius, at 585-409-1088. That's 585-409-1088 for property management, buying, or selling real estate in Western New York. So, boys, we're 2-0. I know it's been a second since it was Thursday. How great was it to sit on your couch lazily watching 7 hours of commercial-free football on Sunday with, you know, no worries, no anxiety, and the first team 2-0 in the books was pretty good. Pretty good.
Pat, how much did you get to watch on Sunday?
I watched a pretty good amount. I watched. Yeah. Let me think here. I watched that Raiders Ravens game. That was a good game.
Not a good ending. Yeah.
For,
a lot of upsets this week.
And that Chiefs Bengals game was
boo.
I don't know, man. And that pass interference call was so late. That was like I don't know. But
yeah, watch, he threw the flag late. But
watch those games. So that was good. Not all bad. And then there was the Giants game as well, which was, you know,
was crazy.
Yeah.
To score three touchdowns and not let anybody score on you and to lose the game. History was made. Yeah.
Right. Was made. Yeah. That's crazy.
I love red zone, first of all. I'll say that every time I can.
Deck a box. We had deck a box this week. It was great.
Yeah. Is deck a 10? 8?
Yes. 10.
Yeah.
10.
So
you teach children, Brandon.
We teach ones through tens, like on little cubes, you know. Yeah. Number
color
blocks.
Counter.
You ever watch number
blocks? You guys haven't made it to Deca,
with the
guess,
number blocks. It's a great show. I golfed on Sunday, which I never, ever, ever do. Ever. I don't think I've golfed on Sunday in forever. Never on a football Sunday. Definitely. But I put my phone there on red zone right in the middle of the cart. And my buddy Adam I was playing with, he had DraftKings up so we could pull up live bets. Filtering through the games. It was tough. The Lions game, at the end of the Lions game, watching that. I watched him blow it on fourth down. Then I shanked a chip because I'm like, I heard him line it up for it and I wasn't focused in the golf game. So I shanked this chip, go back to the cart, watch him throw some bad play calling at the end of that game. And then, you know, I think it was a par three. I got a six on because of that shot. I counted it. I'm like, I should count this as a mulligan because I'm not paying attention. And then they did it again and I did it again because they got the ball back. With like 14 seconds left on the 30, like it's not over yet. And then I was too focused on that. So it was tough to golf and play, but I loved it. It was 80 degrees out. Like, I'm not mad about spending the time like that at all. So it was great. Yeah. It was great. Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. Well, obviously, like just to give you guys a preview of the show, we've got some good stuff coming up. We're going to do our game picks like usual. There's a surprise leader, so stay tuned for that.
That gives it away.
Spoiler alert, he's in a closet right now.
Yeah. Come out, Pat.
And we're going to break down this last game a little bit, talk about some narratives, and maybe look forward to this Monday Night Football game coming up against the Jaguars.
Prime time, baby.
Yeah, I mean, how many of these games are prime time? Because after that, we've got Baltimore Sunday Night Football the following weekend as well, right? So ends up being, what is it, 3 primetime games straight? I guess we probably talked about this when the schedule came out already. Yeah. But
do you know Allen's record in primetime?
It's got to be pretty good. He's 7-0 on Thursday Night Football now. What is he overall in primetime games?
Overall, he is 11-4. I don't know when this was written. 11-4, 40 passing touchdowns, 104 passer rating. I got to see when this article was written.
It's so weird with that, too, because I don't know if that counts playoff games. Is every playoff game a primetime game, technically?
Okay, this was written in, this was November of last year. So this is before the Giants game last year.
Okay.
So they're 11-4 as of week 6 of last year.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's higher than that because they won a couple since then.
And lost that Broncos game.
Oh, yeah.
That was the one. That was the turning point in the season.
Yeah. I would love to know if Ken Dorsey still has a job if we win that game. One of the all-time questions for Bill's podcast to talk about in the future. But Josh Allen on primetime. It's almost like Josh Allen against the Dolphins, except Josh Allen is better against the Dolphins. Who would have thought?
Brandon, you gotta stomp on him, man. You know, you
stomp on him. Well, stomp on him. I feel a little bad for Tua. It kind of took away my feeling. I like Tua. Everybody in the league likes Tua. It's cool. We raised money for his foundation. But yeah, you know, it's cool to be right. Josh Allen and Bills on the Dolphins. So I really like the comments about Super Bowls because you haven't won a playoff game in 25 years, Miami. I like the comments about Josh Allen being good, but not the rest of the Bills beating the Dolphins, except we have held Tyreek under 60 yards. We held Waddle under 60 yards. You know, Achane was the only guy to go off, but the whole
garbage
team
time
owns
stats, a lot of them.
The whole team owns Miami. Poor Tua gets sacked against Miami all the time. The defense plays great. The offense plays great. McDermott's a wizard. What do you want me to say? Go Bills. I don't know. So
I like it. I actually want to talk about McDermott for a second because I wrote this down and I couldn't believe I was writing it, but I was like, this is actually true. And it has to do with kind of our narratives as they go through the season. But hear me out. You ready? This is the hook. McDermott and Josh Allen are the same. Pause. Give me a second.
Everybody's on the edge of their seat.
Give me
all
a second. Okay. So both have shown over time that they're elite, right? Eliteness is not a week to week thing where you're elite every single dang week. Like it's an average over time. You're elite most of the time. And sometimes you're not elite. Like even the elites have bad weeks, right?
But that's when you talk about the floor, right?
That's their floor. But okay. So both Josh and McDermott have some bad moments that stick out, right? Why does Josh have this turnover narrative? Because he does kind of turn the ball over at not an unprecedented rate, but a little bit more than you'd like to, right?
It's probably close. For somebody who's elite, it's probably close to unprecedented, but I'm not worried about it at all. So carry on.
Exactly. And McDermott, you know, I mean, which situation do we choose? You know, is it 13 seconds? Is it calling a cover zero blitz against Denver or something like that? I think everyone could acknowledge that those were mistakes. Sorry,
Hamlin fake punt in a playoff game.
Yes, that probably not.
That one's
not
a little fresh.
You should have watched the Lions throw a pass on fourth down with their punter, not run it with their backup safety. Thought that was cool. Anyways,
I was going to say, if only Jared Goff could have a similar passer rating to the punter in that game, they probably would have done a little bit better. But anyway, I just think that both of them have made considerable efforts to improve on their flaws since they've come into the league and to the large part have succeeded to an elite level, Josh and McDermott included in that. So, and I think that the reason why we get so up and down on these, we don't really get down on Josh, right? Like we defend Josh, but like, as far as everybody across the landscape of the NFL, our narratives revolve around whether the Bills are winning or the Bills are losing. Like that's it. It's like when they were 6-6 last year, when is the McDermott hit piece come out? When are we talking about like, is McDermott on a short string? What does he need to do to get fired? Well, and now they're 2-0. McDermott puts on a masterclass against the best wide receiver duo in the entire league, holds them to historic lows, and we're giving him his flowers because he did it. You know, Terrell Bernard's out of the game. Yeah. He's got this cast of characters that is not the same team as last year. They're only in the second game of the season. There's all these reasons to give McDermott his flowers, but I feel like, you know, like our narrative kind of ebbs and flows with whether they're living or dying by that. So I don't know. I think that Josh Allen and McDermott. Josh Allen probably is a little bit more elite than McDermott. If we're compared to his competition across the league,
I think that's.
But when it comes to like putting together a defense, I think McDermott might be close to that elite in some weeks. But again,
so
you know, we're not saying that after the Cincinnati Bengals playoff loss where the defense didn't look good. So it's all wins and losses based. You know.
Pat, I do want your take on something here, but to follow up what you just said, John, Allen and McDermott being elite. I'm talking about McDermott here being elite because we sit here and, like you said, if you bring in a new head coach and he's a rookie, he has to learn, right? You're going to have mistakes. You have to learn through those lumps. Do you want to do that with a prime Josh Allen? You know, maybe not, but we're still watching McDermott do it, learn, regress.
Progress.
And I thought that fourth down on the first drive, touchdown to James Cook, is a progress point right there, right? The play was like out of Mike McDaniel's playbook. Little motion here, motion there. Boom,
yeah, I was
going
to say, it was actually out of the, they ran that play last year to the other side with a little bit less window dressing, and it worked just as well too, so.
And then he dropped one too, just on that same play. But, so we're talking about replacing him, you know, Ben Johnson, Kevin Kubiak, whoever offensive mind you want to throw out there. But when you look around the league and we see this trend right now, this two high safeties, this slowdown of the offense, the offenses look like they're running through mud sometimes. The Bills have been lucky. They really haven't looked like that. But you look back to 2017 when he started and you had Mahomes on the bench in 2017 and you had Tyrod Taylor for the Bills. But we played cover two high safeties with Poyer and Hyde in 2017 and made the playoffs. So I looked up some stuff because you see this trend really growing in the NFL. And he's the pioneer of it, I think. He might be one of the shovel to groundbreaker here. Let's stick this defense out there against these high-powered offenses. Well, and at the time you're playing Brady.
Isn't it? Well, I mean, I guess theoretically, though, wouldn't it be like two high safeties is, I guess it would be like the Tampa 2, Monty Gibson.
The Tampa 2. And he learns that in Philly. Yep. And who did he have in Philly? He had that legendary
Jimmy coordinator. Johnson, yes.
Jimmy Johnson, yep. Yeah. So, but then you see it kind of change a little bit. I think having that nickel out on the field more than your base 4-3 cover two has kind of been a McDermott wrinkle in this. But anyways, I wanted to look. So we're talking about these sexy offensive coordinators, the Kyle Shanahans and Mike McDaniels, right? And they are drawing up all these crazy plays, scheming their receivers open, you know, doing a great job against most of the league. We have that guy on defense. He is slowing all these teams down in the regular season, unless you're playing the Ravens. Right. So to have McDermott be able to scheme up these suffocating defenses against the Dolphins and the Ravens and you name it. You know, the Dolphins were coming off 70 points last year and we shut them down. And you look around, I wanted to look at it as a historical thing. Like you said, the floor and the ceiling. Yeah. So, but it made me feel so confident because like, who do you want? You want offensive coordinator boost your quarterback? Or do you want this defensive coordinator to complement your offensive quarterback? And we had the offensive coordinator that installed the most important principles in Brian Daboll into Josh Allen. So he knows what he likes because of Brian Daboll. So Josh Allen is now the resource, right? He absorbed that information from Daboll. And I think having him in the room, no matter who the coordinator is, Allen has enough say to say like, this is how we did it. This is how I like to do it. This is how I wouldn't mind changing it, yada, yada, yada. But then you got this rock on this side, McDermott. And I think having them both is so critical to that balance that you were talking about, John. But I looked up scoring defense and passing defense because I was seeing which for McDermott, how great he has been consistently. So since 2017, scoring defense, we're going to go from 2017 to 2024 with their league ranking. 2017, 18th. 2018, 18th. 2019, 2nd. 2020, 16th. Weird. 2021, first. 2022, second. 2023, fourth. 2024, through two games, he's ninth. Then you look at the passing defense overall. 2017, they were 20th. 2018, they were first. 2019, they were fourth. 2020, again, it's weird, they're 13th. 2021, they're first. 2022, they're ninth. 2023, they were seventh. And through two games, they're 13th. So, you know, you have 1 to 18 and 1 to 20 with bad rosters where it settles in like top five. You average those numbers out, you're looking at like 6-7 in the league throughout his whole tenure.
Yeah.
Consistently,
with,
yeah.
With tons of different rosters along the way.
Different rosters. And then now, Pat, this is the part I want to ask you. So now we might actually look at Joe Andreessa because we have a undrafted rookie free agent as a backup on our roster and our starting linebacker seems to be hurt. So here we go. Both of our starting linebackers seem to be hurt. So our only plan here is our backups. Dorian Williams looks good. Braylon Spector looks good, but Joe Andreessa might play, but after watching Cam Lewis and Mark Ingram play, how do you feel about this? You ready to see this guy?
Jamarcus Ingram. Mark Ingram's been gone for a while.
Yeah.
It's an interesting narrative, though, too, because, I mean, you look at all those classic defenses and you think about how people, I mean, obviously, like you said, you want to give Sean McDermott his kudos, but it was always part of the narrative that Sean McDermott was working with Micah Hyde and Jordan Poyer to run these complex schemes that, you know what I mean? You know, it was like a team effort. And not to say, like you said, not to say that Jamarcus Ingram and Cam Lewis aren't, you know, super experienced masterminds out there, but I feel like that does kind of, you know, show a little bit more of Sean's prowess in terms of.
And maybe that's why, Pat, also they decided to roll with Damar Hamlin and Taylor Rapp as their starting safeties this year rather than the higher ceiling guys with Mike Edwards and Cole Bishop. You know, because those guys have been in the system for at least a year. DeMar's been in the system for more than that, you know, three years now. And they got to learn behind Hyde and Poyer for that time, too. So, you know,
Taylor Rapp
there's overlap
good.
There. Yeah,
he did. He did.
I thought he looked good.
Yeah, which better than last year when he came in, right? So, I don't know. I feel like the more, again, we're only two games into it, so I don't want to overreact. But every single decision that Brandon Bean made this offseason, it's kind of looking like he really knew what he was doing.
There, except, right? Except when you see that Xavier Worthy touchdown, you know, on Sunday. Sometimes
I'm still withdrawing. I'm still holding back my opinion until the end of the year.
I'm trying to
Xavier
as well.
Worthy or Keon Coleman, because you know Keon only gets like one target in this game, so we don't really see a lot of him. But we did see him flash in the opener. So there's that. But
my five words to that are John, throw Curtis Samuel the.
I was going to say, are you hitting the panic button yet, Brando?
Yes, I am.
There's no poster behind you. The toes are tough, man.
Yeah, the poster wouldn't really go up very much. It's there, but it's so small, you can't
see
it. It'll
be empty.
Yeah.
Well, it's Curtis Samuel at like three receptions so far this year, two?
Yeah, I think it's three for 20 yards, maybe.
They seem to be using it as more of a decoy. They'll put him in the backfield, and they haven't given it to him once.
I'm interested. I would love to know if he's an option on these plays, and Allen just reads the right open read and he's just not giving it to him, or if there's a issue. I haven't really watched enough of the like film to see if he's getting open and not getting the ball, but they haven't needed it, which is fine. And it circles back, John, we talked about this all off season that this team might look massively different and be just as good, which they are doing right now. And I looked at the play calling, 59 runs to 43 passes, about 55% higher than Joe Brady did last year in his, you know,
is that the total for this season?
So far.
Yeah. And obviously a lot of that's probably game script specific because they were up so hot much in the Miami game, right?
I don't know, man. The Cardinals game, they ran the ball a lot too, and they weren't winning except when they were down. There's a stretch of time. There's like 10 minutes of game time when they're down that they just lit up the passing charts, which they completed them and they were successful. So it gave me hope to be like, maybe this is what McDermott has wanted right here, right? He's getting what he wants, I think, more than anything, because he can have James Cook up a great six-course meal and score three touchdowns, but he can also have Josh Allen, when they're down two scores, throw darts to Khalil Shakir. And, you know, find these open guys. It was nice to see Kincaid get involved, but he has choices now, and this is going to be really cool to see if the Bills ever need it to get to that next gear, because they did show that they could do it in their 12 minutes of being down against the Cardinals. But Jacksonville, maybe you have to, you know, Trevor Lawrence seems to play well against us. I don't know what his deal is.
I was going to say, I was set on getting that McDermott Allen narrative out before this game, because I'm like, you know, I'm just trying to set myself up. Like, they're going to lose some games this year, guys. Like, it's going to happen. We can't get too far down, right? Like, you know, the highs are good. You can get as high as we want, but maybe not as low as we need to in their house. Because like Jacksonville, I mean, that's got Admiral Akbar written like all over it. So, but
Admiral Akbar.
It's a trap.
Oh, it's a trap. Oh, from Star Wars. Yeah. Whatever. When you go, 14 of 30 for like 200 yards, Trevor was not looking so good, but yeah. Doesn't matter. Doug Peterson, you know, doesn't matter. Urban Meyer, they got her number down there for the most part.
I guess so. Yeah, I was going to say, Pat, like, do you remember your Urban Meyer rant that used to be in the intro of the show for a long time? Like, we need Peterson level rant on that level. Something like that.
Doug Peterson's playing with house money right now. He honestly probably doesn't give a crap about anything. He's already won a Super Bowl ring. He's already turned Trevor Lawrence around. I mean, like, you know.
Trevor Lawrence has been in it circles.
They shouldn't have paid him. Listen, yeah. Mr. Khan made a mistake paying him what they paid him, but I don't know. It'll be an interesting game.
So Trevor Lawrence against a good Cleveland defense. 14 of 30, 220 yards, zero touchdowns, zero interceptions.
Yeah, that game was 66 yards.
Four sacks. Hey, I had Cleveland's defense, so they did pretty well. But Trevor Lawrence, man, I don't know. He likes playing us, but I think Kevin McDermott's magic here. Doug Peterson sounds terrible in the press conference. Did you see it? Yeah. Anybody see a clip of it?
He does. Yeah. He looks really checked out.
Yeah.
Well, and not to tantalize you boys either, but I think we're going to see some elite wide receiver play from a Wookiee ride receiver. A Wookiee ride receiver. Oh my God. He's a Wookiee. A hairy young fellow. But Brian Thomas Jr., though, I'm excited to see him.
He played great.
Yeah. He played good.
Yeah.
The narrative behind this Bills Jags thing, I said it to the Dolphins fans in the comments, you know, beat us by a couple scores more than once and I'll stop. Right. So I think it's the Bills' turn to end this narrative here with Jacksonville. Yeah, let's do something.
The Jags are definitely our daddies for the last couple of years.
You know, and I feel like we got the one win that mattered, you know, when Jalen Ramsey was running his mouth. If we just never beat him again, to know that we beat him in that instance.
We were there for that game, right? We went to that game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does it even count as like a rivalry if they're like, they're just like a thorn in our side kind of team, right? Because they're never there in the playoffs, right? Like,
they beat us in the playoffs when we broke the drought.
That's true. That's
the worst game I ever attended in my
life.
That's
going so far back that I don't even think about that one too much, honestly.
That team was playing in the AFC Championship game, man.
Do you remember how ugly their uniforms were with a half gold helmet?
Yeah.
Oh, that was terrible. That was awful.
No, I'm telling you, that game, I remember I went to that game with my dad. And the stadium's a junk hole. Like, they had seats covered in the 300s at sections because there wasn't enough fans to fill it up. There was a lot of Bills fans there. I had the flu. It was like 50 degrees in the highest row of the 50-yard line and like section 500 to watch the snoozer of a game and to see Nate Peterman.
Yeah, end the game on an interception, dude.
Throw a pick when it's like, he can do this. Let's go. I remember being this like super first play, boom, pick down. Oh, time to go. 10-3.
So bad. But anyway, like I don't know. They're like not a full arch nemesis. They're more of like a Newman, you know, what Newman is to Jerry and Seinfeld, I feel like. Just an annoying little team over there.
I think you're not giving them enough credit against us, though. I feel like they are more than a Newman. They're not our Dolphins, but we lose to them. And we lost to them as the Super Bowl favorite in another one of the worst games of all time.
Yeah. Coach by 9-3?
Worst coach of all time.
Yeah. 9-3 or 6-3.
He scored 3 points in a game against Urban Meyer. That's terrible. It was terrible.
Then he went back to Columbus and grabbed a sophomore's butt at a bar.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Oh, no. I was going to say, I want to see like the last few games that we have. So we are 2-4 against them in the last six, going back to 2015.
2-4.
If you go back to 2009, it's 5 losses and 3 wins. It's pretty split. 4 wins. It's 10-9 all time.
It's not as lopsided as I feel like it was because of the 2 wins, one in 2016 and one in 2018. But yeah, 2 L's since then. I guess the Urban Meyer loss just felt like 3 L's to me.
Yeah,
like
it was.
That was a London game too, wasn't it?
No.
The most recent one was last year.
That's when we lost Milano and the whole defense was hurt and they were the heroic last stand to get the ball back and they blew it.
Ugh, so bad.
Happened on my niece's first birthday. Happy birthday, Finley. The Bills suck. Yeah. Uncle Brandon missed first half of your party to watch this trash. Sorry.
Yeah.
Yep. That was, oh goodness. Yeah. Actually that game started and that was like Elizabeth's, one of our first couple dates. She came over after that and I didn't want to leave the house. Same thing. Cause you know, I was too upset.
Oh, how many months ago was this?
Never mind. Yeah. The viewers don't worry about that. But
one more thing I wanted to bring up with you guys too, is obviously we've been watching, you know, some of these guys play that have moved on from the Bills, right? Or the Bills moved on from them. Trey White and Jordan Poyer specifically. And we've seen Benford and Douglas in contrast on our team with this physical element to their game that it seemed like wasn't always there with the corners that the Bills had previously. Like they kind of had it, you know, like the second corner, Dane Jackson, Levi Wallace, not necessarily physical, but could make a tackle when they needed to. Whereas like Benford and Douglas, 5 stuffs between them in this game. Benford was targeted 9 times in this last game, 4 catches, 25 yards and an interception. And is this the best corner duo we've had post drought?
No.
No? Okay. What's
Douglas though, because he's going to be a free agent after this year. So you better pay him right now. But
well, that's a good question. Like, do they pay him or are they going to try to get Kyer Elam in there? Because Benford's kind of growing older.
You got to take too. Douglas. Keep Douglas for
well,
sure.
Well, no, Kyer Elam and Benford were drafted in the same class, though, too.
It's crazy. Right. That's crazy also.
Yeah,
to miss so highly on this first runner and just, let's take a sixth round guy. All right, we'll give him a try. He's small. Right. He's fast. Oh, okay, we'll take him.
Yeah. Perfect. But what's the better corner duo? Because
okay,
obviously,
a question for you.
Trey at his peak, and who's the best corner you had opposite of him?
Okay, so I was just looking at the 2017
I mean, Josh Norman and Trey, people sleep on that duo too.
EJ Gaines and rookie Trey, you could say rookie Trey came out prime. Like, he came out solidly.
He did.
But if you look at the passing defense, the 2018 defense, their scoring defense was 18th, but their passing defense was first. And then the only other time that they have the first passing defense is in 2021. So those would be the first two. So who's playing corner in 2021?
Levi, I believe.
Levi Wallace. And then who's playing in 2018? EJ Gaines?
It's probably EJ Gaines, yeah.
So statistically saying, it's got to be one of those two.
Who are some of the older corners that we had in? Because we had Josh Norman.
EJ Gaines.
EJ Gaines. Oh, yeah. I was going to say, none of them really played starter roles. We had a couple of throwback names.
Philip Gaines.
Dean Marlowe was a guy who was
Dean
around
Dean Marlowe.
For,
well, he was like a safety hybrid, though, I guess.
Yeah. Saron Neal also was kind of like a big nickel special teams player. Kevin Johnson was the other guy that I was trying to think of. Kurt Coleman was another older guy that they brought in. But
I think you got to say it is because Levi Wallace is on the team both years that they have the best passing defenses. So it's got to be Trey White, Levi Wallace, Taron Johnson are the top three corners that we've had. Those three are on both teams leading the NFL
with
in defense.
Taron Johnson being the nickel corner.
Slot corner. Still counts. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm counting him in this lineup as well, even though he's injured right now. But anyway, I might go with Benford and Rasul Douglas, but at this point, but
they might finish first in passing defense this year, which
I guess we'll see. Don't jinx it. But
and they play a cool style. You're definitely right with the eye test alone. They plays a little bit different. I mean, PFF just did an article. Christian Benford staking a claim to the titles of NFL's most underrated defensive back. And his stats are pretty good. I mean, his coverage grade against Miami is 80.3 and 73.4 against Arizona. You know, 7 tackles against Miami. That's pretty good.
Yeah, for sure. Well, you want to get into some game picks here?
Yes, sir. Sorry. I was reading this article. It's pretty good. He's only missed 1.9% of his tackles, Christian Benford.
That's really impressive.
Yeah.
But all right, Brandon, take us away in the recap.
All right. Our pick six pick'em recap week 2. We have a leader in the clubhouse who we have only said that a few times in our history on this show. Pat Kapp finishing with a 3-3 record to take his overall winning record.
6-6.
6-6. 500 record. I guess he's winning against us. He's 500 overall. He picked Green Bay, the Jets, and New England. John and I, we struggled. We picked pretty much exactly the same, and we both finished 2-4 yet again, finishing at 4-8 for our 2 weeks here. So, and Brando's bets, that was a struggle. Allen, 225 passing yards. That did not hit. So as we move into week 3, we need to make up some games here. We are 2 games back with 6 to play. So we could take the lead here, John, if Pat chokes one away. But he's gone perfect, and he's gone on perfect. 6-0, 0-6. So what are we going to get? We don't know. TD Tutty taking it to the house. Whatever you call a touchdown, they matter more at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sportsbook partner of the NFL. Are you ready to place your first NFL bet? Try betting on something simple, like a player to score a touchdown. Maybe it's James Cook to score a touchdown. Maybe it's Josh Allen to score a touchdown. Seems to be like automatic money for Josh Allen to score a touchdown on the ground if he's going to hurdle Jordan Poirier. Maybe we can put that in specifically. I don't know. Find out on DraftKings. Are you ready to do a touchdown dance of your own? Score big with DraftKings Sportsbook, the number one place to bet touchdowns. Download the DraftKings Sportsbook app now and use code NABP. That is code NABP, not another Buffalo podcast, for new customers to get $250 in bonus bets when you bet just $5 and get 1 month of NFL Plus premium only on DraftKings. The crown is yours.
Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. In New York, call 877-8-HOPE-NY or text HOPE-NY 467-369. In Connecticut, help is available for problem gambling. Call 888-789-7777 or visit ccpg.org. Please play responsibly. On behalf of Boot Hill Casino and Resort in Kansas, 21 and over, age and eligibility varies by jurisdiction. Void in New Hampshire, Oregon, and Ontario. Bonus bets expire 168 hours after issuance. For additional terms and responsible gaming resources, see dkng.co/ftball. NFL Plus Premium offer available only to new and former NFL Plus subscribers. Additional NFL Plus Premium terms at nfl.com/terms.
All right, so we see the divisional matchup. New England at the Jets. Jets are 6-point favorites. Pat, this is a Pat game, I think. What do you think? Are you looking forward to this game?
Well, I guess I did forget I did watch the Jets-Titans game. Jets were really struggling, but they seemed to hit. You know, their stride in the fourth quarter. I can't believe I'm saying this.
Will Levis gift.
Yeah, well, you know, he runs around. It's entertaining to watch him play, I will say. I'll take the Jets. I'll take the Jets at home.
All right, Pat taking the Jets on the spread. This New England team looks like the same old scrappy defensive team that they're kind of known for. So they're just going to keep trying to win by not making mistakes. And for that reason, I'm just going to take the points, play it safe. I think the Jets win, but I'm going to take the +6.
All right, +6 is a safe play. I do agree with you. This is going to be a defensive battle, but as the Patriots look more like them, the raggedy old selves on offense and the stronger defense, but the Jets are bringing in the third best defense from the NFL last year, first passing defense in the NFL last year. They're going to confuse Jacoby Brissett. Give me the Jets at home to cover.
Over under 2.5 passes thrown by Rodgers to the right side.
Did he not throw to his right side at all?
He hasn't been. Have you seen the memes? Like, if no. You see a meme of Aaron Rodgers with a patch on his eye and he's looking like a pirate, it's paired with his passing chart.
Do you think it's because of his foot?
I don't know. It might be. It might just be how the offense turned out, and it's just an anomaly. So I'll have to look at this this past week, too, because I know that was the case week one.
I'll make this quick because I think this is kind of interesting. Kirk Cousins and Aaron Rodgers both had the least amount of yards ran in the pocket ever in like their career over two games, which was indicative for their Achilles injuries.
Yep.
And it's like really holding them back. So I think both of those guys are feeling it to start this year. Yep. So that'll be a good trend to watch. But we are not picking the Falcons. We are going to go see those squished fishies that they're taking their East Coast team all the way to the West Coast to Seattle. And they are taking out the Seahawks.
Time for Brando's Bets.
Birds take fish out of the ocean before. Is that going to happen today? John, what do you think?
Everyone loves marine land. No, I think that the Dolphins have a full week of the Skylar Thompson install in. They still got Tyreek and Waddle and those guys. I feel like Seattle's not going to defend them as well as the Bills did. So give me the points. 5.5. I like it.
You like the points this week. Pat, what do you think? I do.
Give me Eugene Cyril Smith III and those Seattle Seahawks. Yeah, I'll take them. The 12th man, very loud over there in Seattle.
Pat, I agree with you, but I agree with you because Geno is smoking hot right now. Dude is on fire to start the season. Lighting it up against New England last week.
Yeah, and he's got two elite wide receivers. I would say
he might have
three if you count. I mean, Lockett, JSN? Smith, and Smith in
Jackson, yes. Smith and
JSN. Jabba, and DK. But yeah.
So give me that. Geno's better than whoever Miami trots out on the field. Now, these two teams, they just played some wild games. The Lions at the Cardinals this week. Lions stinker against the Bucs. Kyler Murray played a perfect game just about. So we are going to see Detroit go to Arizona. Detroit is a -3-point favorite, John. You were on the Cardinals last week, right?
Detroit is a 3-point favorite in this one.
What did I say? I said there.
You said Arizona. It's all right.
Detroit is a 3-point favorite in this one. John, what do you think?
I'm going to keep going with my points trend here. I'm going to take Arizona +3. And I know that probably pains you a little bit, Brando, but I think that Marvin Harrison Jr. is going to be a tough matchup for this Lions secondary. And they might do it again because the new COD isn't out yet. So Kyler Murray still focused.
Well, we were saying this when the Cardinals were playing the Bills. The Cardinals are going to be a lot better with Kyler Murray this year. And he showed it this week. He's looked like a top 5 player. Dan Orlovsky called him a top 5 player in the league, but Lions avenge their game. They're going to win this one on the road. They're not going to drop 2 in a row. Give me the Lions here. And Pat, what do you think?
I'll also take the Lions. Excited to see. Going to be a good game.
Yep. It should be a good game. So now we're going to Minnesota, where Houston travels to Minnesota to take on the Vikings. Houston is a 3-point favorite on this one. And Diggs didn't really get his revenge game against Minnesota when they were in Buffalo with that fumble on the goal line Allen had, if you recall.
That's to this day is the craziest game I've ever seen. Hands down.
That was wild. Wildness.
We've had a couple of those.
Yeah, we've had a few of them. But what do you think here? Does Diggs get his revenge finally against Minnesota with CJ Stroud, or does Sam Darnold show he's legit, John?
Well, Sam Darnold seems to be a very good revenge quarterback, but I don't think he has any beef with the Texans. So I'm going to go Houston -3 and take the favorite on this one.
Fair enough.
Pat, what about you, man?
Upset. Big upset. Big upset. Class of 2019. That's right. Sam Darnold representing. I think they went, 3-1 last week? That's what a great year to be drafted. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
I would love.
Where's Josh Rosen at? Where's he at?
Oh, God. Yeah. Maybe he had a good
weekend. He went 1-0 and flipping burgers.
I was going to say, maybe he had a great week at Chick-fil-A, employee of the month or something. Yeah. Maybe.
Still, one of those times that if they ever clipped it and you'd be down bad. I remember calling Sal Capaccio and be like, Josh Rosen's going to be the new sheriff in town when Brady retires, man, for the Buffalo Bills. Give me this guy, pocket passer. You know, he's going to light it up. So, and then I wanted Sam Darnold too. But give me the career arc for Sam Darnold against the Jets, right? Zach Rosen, Geno Smith, Zach Wilson, Geno Smith, make it Sam Darnold. But I'm taking Diggs' revenge game here. Give me Houston.
Nice. Houston -3 for Brando.
Yep. All right. Baltimore at Dallas. Two teams coming off a loss. Who avenges their loss, Pat? Which one of these guys bounces back for a win this week?
I got to go with the Ravens. I don't know. That Saints game was bizarre, man.
They're 14 for 14 possessions. They scored on all 14 of their possessions this year.
Are we putting in waiver claims for Derek Carr tonight?
Like, oh, he's already taken in most leagues, I think.
He's available in its league.
Is he?
Yeah. He is. I shouldn't have told you guys that. You guys are both ahead of me in the waiver order.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
I've got Dak Prescott as my quarterback. I could really use a little substitution here.
Yeah, you could. I mean, I don't know.
But I already used the claim already this week. I usually like to go claimless for the first few weeks so I can get up in the order for important stuff. But yeah, I don't know. I like Baltimore -1 here, but this is probably like my wishy-washiest pick that I'm like the least sure about it. Cause I don't know which Dallas team is going to show up. The Dallas team that won whatever 9 or 8 games at home in a row or something like that. And then, you know, obviously lost on the road in the playoffs, but these are two really, not really good teams, but good teams that are trying to avoid like absolute disaster starts. Like, I don't want to say this game is like make or break for both of these teams, but if you're looking at playoff percentages, like one of these teams is going to drop to like a below 30% playoff chance if they lose this game, I would think. So I know it's early on in season, but Dallas D looks like Swiss cheese right now. So I got to go Baltimore.
You're taking Baltimore. All right. You know, you gave the stat. They won 8 in a row. They went perfect at home last year. The Cowboys did.
Yeah.
8-0 on their Jerry World field. So give me the Cowboys to bounce back here. I'm really pushing down the Ravens. I hope that Lamar Jackson's MVP narrative goes down and Josh Allen's goes up. All right. We talked about it a little bit. Does Doug Peterson get fired? I'll tell you, yes. Give me the Bills. Blowout. Bills domination. Fire Doug Peterson. He doesn't care. He can kiss his ring goodbye. Trevor Lawrence, you're a bust. Get our revenge here. You will not be equal to us anymore, Jacksonville. We shake it off on primetime. Allen wins another one in front of everybody. John, what do you think?
You know me, man.
Go Bills.
Yeah. Pat, what about you? Are you doing your classic Bills to win, not to cover?
Yeah, Bills to win, not to cover, but they win, and Gabe Davis has a drop wide open in a critical situation in the game. I wish you could do a prop bet on that, but you can't.
I think it's under.
I like
under on receptions, yes.
I like Pat's wild predictions.
Yeah.
New segment incoming.
That'd be a cool segment.
Well, sweet. All right. So Pat doing his classic win not to, okay, yeah. So we got it. Pat's a little behind on the spreadsheet. I'm looking at it live here.
Yeah, that's the only one I didn't fill out here. Crap. Jack.
John, we're gonna have some movement on the standings one way or another here.
I think so. Yeah. Differently. We did this week. So one of us is gonna be. The overall records, Pat's 6-6, I'm 4-8, and Brando's 4-8 as well. So not a hot start, but we're just getting warmed up with the season. Spreads are hard to pick. If we were picking straight up, we'd have good records too.
Yeah, it's really inflating our overall records.
We got burned by 2 half-point hooks last week, Brando. Yes, we did. It was Seattle didn't cover a 3-point spread. They only won by 3.
Mm-hmm.
Kansas City didn't cover their spread, which was they missed it by 5 points, which is fair, but Jacksonville got upset, and then Indianapolis just what are they clunker. Doing?
Yeah.
That was a clunker. Malik Willis's completions under hit, which was my bet of the week, yeah, but I don't know.
On the ball is a great story.
that's crazy. Wait, what? Did you see that, Pat?
No.
There was Malik. You know what's funny is Malik Willis might have gone for certain lines, he would have gone over on completions had he thrown that ball.
Really?
But the center, Pat, that you'll see the video, the center of the Packers threw up on the ball right before he snapped it.
Like laying down in the position in his tech.
In his stance. Yeah. Just threw up on the ball, snapped it, and then Malik like
he couldn't throw it because it was all like, wet. Critical game.
Point in the game.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. So oof.
Look it up. You'll find
it. You gotta hold it in or you gotta get it up like Josh before the game at that point. I mean,
you never thrown up in a game?
No.
No. Thrown up at a swim meet.
Yeah.
But anyway, I think that's gonna wrap it up for this week. You guys know where to find us on all platforms at Not Buff Podcast. Pat, wish you a happy next week of dadding. Hope you get some more sleep. And
yeah. Nice hat.
Thanks, man.
Brothers. Love I like that. Yep.
Remember, it's Monday Night Football this week. So another Sunday of commercial-free football for everyone to enjoy. A little bit of anxiety because you got to worry about the Bills game coming up. But
just enjoy the spot at the top of the conference right now.
Yeah. It is a Monday Night Football doubleheader, too, which is interesting to note.
We got the 7:30 start. It's a little earlier because there's a late game, right?
Yeah. So it's great for those of you who value sleep, which Falcons I think is right all now, of us. Right? Yep. That's going on right now.
Who's playing after them?
It's a doubleheader next week when the Bills play on Monday Night Football, not tonight.
Gotcha.
I don't know who else is playing, but we'll take
a look at it. Bucks, sneaky good. But
Baker Mayfield on a tear.
Yep.
All right, we'll see you guys next week. Go Bills.
Go Bills.